We have wounded one another and sinned We have not always recognized the Holy Spirit dwelling in each of us. Remember your covenant, renew your creation, restore us that we might proclaim your liberties to all.
The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. God has spoken. The time of grace is now. In Jesus, the reign of God has come near. By the authority of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are God's beloved.
Amen.
Thank you.
resplendent light of your truth shines from the mountaintop into our hearts. Transfigure us by your beloved Son and illumine the world with your image. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
A reading from 2 Kings. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" He said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" He answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The waters parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You've asked a hard thing, yet if you do not see me as I'm being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see them, he grasped his own clothes and tore them into two pieces. The word of the Lord.
Children, I would like to join me. is. Can you tell me what it is? That is exactly what that is. If anyone didn't hear him, he said it's something that is living that turns into something new, and that is just about right. It is something that is living, like you said, and it turns into something beautiful. So we're going to look at caterpillars. I guess I have that upside down. So we all know that caterpillar starts and ends, right? Pretty normal, you can't see it, and then it turns into what? A caterpillar, and then it goes into this little cocoon, right? A cute way. I don't know the direct translation. It's been a while since I've done this. And then it goes into its little cocoon, and then it turns into what? Something beautiful, right? A butterfly. And so today in our gospel, we're going to hear about how Jesus was transfigured. He took some people up to a mountain, and they all thought it was pretty normal, and then it was like all of a sudden big, white, beautiful. Think about it. No, have you ever been to the beach? Yeah, I'm sure you've been to the beach, right? And you go, you see the water all sparkly because the sun's shining down on it. It's kind of what Jesus looks like. Do you imagine Jesus is having sparkles all over him and just lighting up the world? Everyone is just amazed. Just like you are when you look at a butterfly because they're just so beautiful, right? So we're going to learn about that in today's gospel. Jesus is pretty, pretty cool. He's pretty dazzling. He's pretty bright. Okay? All right, can you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for giving us the image of being transfigured and that you are something bright in our lives that we can continue to look at. We ask that you look over us and keep us bright throughout this week and as we go into our Lenten journey later this week. In your name we pray. Amen. You have your very own butterfly. And you're very
such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking to Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, is it good for us to be here? Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." And suddenly when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. And as they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Well, good morning, Good Shepherd. As Pastor Perry said, my name is Michael Schulte, and I am the pastor and mission developer at The Collective in Atlanta, Georgia. I'm very thankful that Pastor Perry has allowed me to come and invited me to come and share more about our ministry in Atlanta. The Collective, as she said, is a church without walls, and our mission is to provide a compelling vision of love and belonging to new generations of people, especially those who have been hurt by the church or those who have become disconnected from a faith community. And when we talk about new generations, we of course mean young adults, we mean college-age students, but we mean so much more than that. We mean people of diverse sexual and gender identities who have often been told that church is not a place for them. We mean people in their middle ages who have become disenchanted with the church and have disconnected from organized religion. We really need anyone in Atlanta who feels lost and lonely and longing for a community where they can wrestle with the deep questions of God. Right, the vision of the collective was birthed out of my own experience as a young person trying to find a church home. I graduated from college in Missouri, and I moved down to Memphis, Tennessee to be a public school teacher. And what I wanted to do was to find community like I had back home. And oftentimes, I actually went to Lutheran school, K-12. The church was the center of my community. So I hoped to find that there. And when I was looking for churches in Memphis, what I would often find is I was left with two options. I could go to a traditional Lutheran, Presbyterian, Methodist church, and I would be familiar with the liturgy. There would be a theology of welcome there, but oftentimes in those places, I'd be the only person in my early 20s. And oftentimes, I'd be the only person there under the age of 40. And so my second option was to attend a non-denominational church. And they had the modern music, and they had robust small groups, and they had a whole lot of young people. But the problem was that these churches is that they forced me to check my values at the door, because they are churches that did not ordain women. Women oftentimes couldn't even pray in front of the church. There are churches that were unwelcoming to queer people. And there are churches that had these long lists of written and unwritten rules about that you had to follow so that you could be considered this sort of good Christian. But they had young people. So that, more often than not, is where I went to church. And so the collective seeks to try to bridge that gap, to exist beyond that binary, to say that there are people where there can be a church where young people can come and attend and grow in faith with God and not check their values at the door. Right? We seek to borrow structures from the non-denominational churches that are often growing by the hundreds and thousands in our communities, and to mix that with Lutheran theology. Because we dare to believe that a Lutheran church can be compelling and modern and relevant and committed to our historic Lutheran confessions. And we seek to really be a place where people can wrestle with the transcendent mystery of Christ. In today's gospel text, we witness Christ, both how Christ exists in the world, but also how Christ exists beyond our conception, beyond our world. We witness this transcendent Christ who comes to be in relationship, who comes to live in our neighborhoods. Right in our text, Jesus leads Peter and James and John up to a mountain, and there he's transfigured. And Mark writes that Christ's clothes become dazzling, such as no one on earth could bleach them. Then Elijah and Moses appear and talk with Jesus, which must be pretty cool. But then in the grand finale, God the Creator speaks from heaven and says, "This is my Son, my beloved. Listen to him." And I think one of the purposes of the Transfiguration story is to illustrate the nature of Christ. A chapter earlier in Mark 8, Jesus asks his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And the disciples respond, "Some people call you John the Baptist. Some people think you're Elijah or one of the prophets." Like Moses, Jesus may have been called to lead his people out of bondage. Right? But his deliverance transcends our earthly existence, because Jesus exonerates us not from earthly rulers, but from sin and from death. A deliverance that Moses, a mere human, cannot manifest. And like Elijah, Jesus might speak truth to the religious authorities, illustrating that the God of Israel is the God of the universe. But unlike Jesus, Elijah is not God. He's just merely a human messenger for God on this earth. So Jesus is not Elijah. Jesus is not one of the prophets. Jesus is not one of the patriarchs. Jesus is our Savior and Lord. And that's the profound truth of the Transfiguration story. That this person that the disciples are following is indeed the Son of God. And this story foreshadows what will come. That Jesus is not merely a prophet, because Jesus eventually in this text will defeat death and the grave. Jesus will conquer the adversary, and we believe that one day Jesus will come again to reign in justice and power and to restore the world to God's sacred purposes. Right? We worship a God whose story does not end in suffering and death, but a God whose story ends in resurrection and in new life. A God who works in our world today to restore it. And thanks be to God, because our churches really need that Jesus. Jesus, the restorer, now more than ever. In 2020, for the first time in the United States history, membership at churches fell below the majority. Right, in 2020, 47% of Americans identified as belonging to some sort of religious sect, whether that be Christianity or Judaism, Islam, etc. And as membership in faith communities has declined, we have seen a rise of what we call the nuns. The nuns are people who do not affiliate with any sort of religion. And they make up roughly 20%, or 1 in 5 people in the United States. That 20% is the same amount of people in our country who identify as Roman Catholic, and the same amount of people who identify as evangelical. In our denomination, the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, we're no stranger to this disaffiliation. We're no stranger to people leaving our churches. Right? Each year, the ELCA nationally loses at least 70,000 members per year. And our membership is also the fourth oldest among all major United States or American denominations. Our average age is 67.4 years old. And while there's nothing wrong with being 67.4, I think that's how old my dad is, it is an issue, because if the trends hold, our churches will really cease to exist by the time I hope to retire as a pastor. Right? And so many churches, our budgets are tight, our buildings are breaking, and the future seems dire. We remember a time when the building was full, when children were here, when youth were here. We remember those times, but we have to remember that death and decline does not have the final word. That God does. And our God is a God of new life, a God of vision, and a God of might. A God who equips and empowers us to go out into the world to share the gospel story to new generations of people, people who would never just naturally walk through the doors of our churches. And at the collective, what we really hope to do is to join you and other congregations in the Southeastern Synod in offering a new vision for God's people. And to give you a little bit of information about our ministry is centered on small groups. We have 3 active small groups which engage 20 to 30 people every single week, and we hope to continue to add more. And we also have just begun in December to host monthly pop-up worship events, and we have those in a fellowship hall in Atlanta, and so far we have around 50 people who attend each of those worship services. And it's so clear that in this short 6 or 7 months that we have been working in the city, that the Spirit is at work. That there are people who long to hear the gospel message, that there are people longing for community and hope and grace in their lives, and the church can be a place which provides that. And there are several ways. So one of the ways I go to churches all across Metro Atlanta and ask for support. Because just as your church was founded, I believe, on April something, 1989, our church was just founded this year. Just as your church was founded, was supported by congregations across our synod, we hope to have the support of other churches as we try to plant this new congregation. So there's several ways that you can be supportive of us. The first is that we really covet your prayers, because at the end of the day here, 95% of church new starts fail. And that's a pretty big number. But I would not have uprooted my life and moved to Atlanta if I didn't think that we had a shot to make this thing work. I didn't think God was calling our community to start something new. And so I hope you'll pray for us that we'll be part of that 5%. That we will be a sustainable church that will connect with new people in ways that engage them. A second thing is this, that in so many of our churches in Metro Atlanta, we have young people who grew up in our church and they moved to the city. but then they don't go to church anymore. And so if you know somebody who lives in Atlanta or Decatur, basically like inside the perimeter, and they're maybe looking for a church, I'd love to connect with them. I do a lot of one-on-ones at coffee shops and breweries and all these things, and that's our number one way of connecting with people, is referrals from others. So if you know of a person, there's no age limit on this, if you know of a person looking for a church in Atlanta, we would love to meet and connect with them. And finally, we're a scrappy grassroots organization. And so the most awkward thing I always get to ask for is that if you feel like you support our mission and vision, and you feel like you are interested in engaging these new, young, and diverse Lutherans, it'd be such a blessing to receive financial support. Right? This sort of support helps us to do things like pay worship leaders, helps us to host community events, helps us to do service projects. Our goal this year is actually to do 5,000 hours of service and advocacy. And that's our big goal for 2024, to engage people. So a lot of that money goes back into the community. But let's go back to the gospel reading. Right, today's gospel, Peter indicates that maybe they should stay on this mountain, that they should build a dwelling for Moses, and one for Elijah, and one for Jesus. And oftentimes our churches today are really insular places. We built a dwelling for ourselves, but we're not willing to change and evolve in ways that would connect with new people. And yet, we have to remember this, that God never wanted God's message to be contained on the mountaintop. That the Jesus movement is not an exclusive movement. It's not built for this esoteric, select, and chosen few. Right? It's built for all people. And it's our job, as witnesses of the resurrection, to share the story of contagious joy with people in our community. People in our community desperate for a word of grace and belonging. That means we've got to get out of the insular walls of our church and lean into the discomfort of inviting people, of asking people their stories, of walking alongside people in their lived experiences. Right? The bottom line is this, that we might have just heard some dire statistics about the church, but we ain't dead yet. And I believe that the Spirit is working to engender a revival in our churches. A revival that says that there's nothing. Not who you are, not what you have done, not anything that can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Right, we worship a God of transformation, a God whose message is still compelling today, and so we are not done yet. Because we worship a God of endless possibility. A God in Jesus Christ who looks at you just as he looked at Jesus on the mountaintop and says to you, "You are my child, my beloved." And his beloved children, God equips and empowers each one of us with the gifts we need to transform our churches and to transform our communities. To go out and to say to people, there is a God that loves you without condition. So friends, God's grace and God's love, it's for you. And you don't have to earn it. There will always be enough love to go around with God. And no matter what the world says, you are loved. And that's pretty great news. In response to that news, it's our job to get our rear ends outside of these pews and to go out beyond our doors and to tell the story in a way that's relevant. To tell people in our community, God's love is for you, God's grace is for you, you are God's beloved children. That's our opportunity to go and tell the story, and it's all that easy, and it's all that hard. Amen.
Thank you.
maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate in the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Christ embodied in human form, we pray for God's blessing on the church, the world, and all of creation. We pray for the church that the transformational power of God enters the hearts of all people. May its leaders serve as examples of your grace and healing across time and space. God of grace, we pray for the creation that we will humbly observe the swirl of wind and the heat of the bright sun. Teach us to honor all you have made and to care for the animals, plants, air, and bodies of water of this planet. God of grace, we pray for those charged with leadership, lawmaking, and governance of our towns, states, and countries, that they will strive for goodness and justice all the days of their lives and callings. God of grace, we pray for any who are sick and suffering, especially Ben, Barb, Dewey, and Jennifer, and those we name silently or aloud at this time. Guide us to offer hospitality, shelter, friendship, and care to any in need. God of grace,
receive our prayer.
We pray for this congregation and its ministry in the wider community. May we share the transforming beauty and love of God in ways that honor the dignity of all whom we encounter. God of grace,
receive our prayer.
Trusting that all the saints, prophets, and those who die in faith are held in your care, we remember in thanksgiving those who have died. Grant us your gift of salvation as we await your coming again in glory. God of grace,
receive our prayer.
Knowing the Holy Spirit intercedes for us, we offer these prayers and the silent prayers of our hearts in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. God, who calls each star by name, we remember all who have died, especially our sister Virginia, all who mourn with your mercy and care. Give us hope in your promised salvation. God of grace,
receive our prayer.
All these prayers we lift up to you in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We share that peace one with the other.
Thank you.
he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us now in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever.
Gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
You all may be seated.
This morning we have regular bread as well as gluten-free. The darker liquid is the wine, the lighter liquid in the center is the juice. If you would prefer a pre-packaged communion kit, those are available from the ushers and contain grape juice as well as flavor. The table is now ready and all are welcome.
Thank you. Body of Christ, be with you. Body of Christ, be with you. Body of Christ, be with you. Soon, so make sure you sign up today.
The registration for our Hunger Walk team is now open, and we are accepting donations for the cause. You can see the display with the big sheet for more information. Continue to look at all the sign-up opportunities and information in the fellowship hall at Sign Up Central, your weekly sheet buzz, and the church calendar posted on our website. If you're not receiving the sheet buzz, as always, you can drop your email on a post-it note, visitor card, drop them off, and play, or just let us know. And now I'm going to invite Donna.
Good morning. On behalf of the Long Range Planning Task Force, I would like to thank you again for attending the conversation circles. We had our last conversation circle last Sunday, and that too was also a resounding success. We've now heard roughly 100 voices from our congregation. And these voices will contribute to the next steps for the Long Range Planning Task Force. A huge, huge thank you to everyone who participated. If you were not able to come, last week there was a special sheet buzz, and in Friday's sheet buzz there was a form that was linked so that you too could have an opportunity to add your input on the questions that were discussed. In addition, there's some paper copies in a basket on the welcome desk. So if you prefer to fill out questions in that manner, that is also available. You can leave those completed forms in my mailbox, which is right across from Pastor Perrin's office. We would like to hear from everyone. That includes our youth members. So if you're a parent or a youth member that's present here, please make sure that you add your input, whether it's through the Google form or through the hard copy. We want to make sure that everybody is heard from. The task force will be meeting again soon to discuss what was heard, categorize the themes, and take steps to formalize some of the direction for Good Shepherd. Please continue to pray for this group, asking the Holy Spirit to be ever present in our conversations. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. And the final announcement is, I hope everyone has heard about worship matters, because worship really, really does matter in this place. We're doing six-week small group studies, so 6 weeks, that's it, just 6 weeks, and we would love for everyone to be part of this study. There are groups that are formed during the day, there are some in the evening, there are some on Zoom, there are all different formats, so we're hoping that took all of your excuses away, and I'm not but seriously, we would love to have everybody as part of it. I think you'll learn a lot about our Lutheran worship service, but in addition, I think you'll also meet some new people. And I think that's an important thing as we head forward into this next phase of ministry at Good Shepherd. So please rise now as you are able to bless. Now may the God who names you, Christ who claims you, and the Holy Spirit who dwells in you bless you and remain with you always. Amen.
going to have a good week. I think this is spring. What do you think?
This is fall, so this is first fall spring.
I would like to think so, but I'm afraid it's not.
We have two more fall springs before we get real.